Anyway, I am a little, a couple of minutes over time, so I'm going to start this meeting, a public board meeting for April 12th. And I wish to acknowledge that we are on Treaty 4 territory, traditional lands of the Nehiyawak, Nakaway, Nakota, and homeland of the Métis, Lakota, and Dakota. And tonight we're trying a little bit of a different system here because our live stream doesn't work that well. And so Twyla is taping it, is she?
Yes.
Video. Okay, so we have Twyla doing some video taping, and we have some of you at home joining us on Teams. And of course, we have us here in the boardroom on Teams as, sorry, in person, but we're looking at our Teams as well. So I have opening prayer, and let's see. You want me just to start this? Okay. Please join me. Sorry, that's Juliet starts.
That's okay, Ricky. Please join me in the sign of our faith in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus is risen. Hallelujah. Let us sit back and relax as we listen to this beautiful song that sums up the Christian story of Easter.
A crown of thorns placed on his head. He knew that he would soon be dead. He said, "Did you forget me, Father? Did you?" They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ the King before his hallelujah. 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 His head and prepared to die, then lifted his face up to the sky, said, "I am coming home now, Father, to you." A reed which held his final sleep was gently lifted to his lips. He drank his last and gave used his sword to pierce the body of our Lord, said, "Truly this was Jesus Christ, our Savior." He looked with fear upon his sword, then turned to face his Christ and Lord, fell to his knees, crying, "Hallelujah. Took from his head the thorny crown and wrapped him in a linen gown, then laid him down to rest inside the tomb. The holes in his hands, his feet inside, now in our hearts we know he died. Days went by, again they came to move the stone, to bless the slain with oil and spice, anointing, hallelujah. But as they went to move the stone, they saw that they were not alone, for Jesus Christ has risen.
Thank you, Heavenly Father, for giving up your only Son, Jesus, for us. Please join me in praying the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
It's your last chance. Don't miss these incredible savings.
In heaven, give us bread.
And 60% off proudly Canadian-made sofas.
Forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
By the matching love seat or chair. This 17 cubic foot counter depth fridge, just $9.49. And this LG 55 inch 4K smart TV is only $5.49. And shop your way.
And a new earth. Light a flame in our hearts so that we too may be renewed in holiness. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you. Just love that song. I listened to it so many times during Easter. It's beautiful. Broke up a little bit during with our technology, but hey, we got through. Just wanted to certainly recognize everyone who's joined us on this Teams meeting tonight. And as I mentioned, a special welcome to Oksana and Susan. Who were former colleagues in teaching and administration with me a long time ago. And I don't know, do we have our student trustees online here? Ian and Sarah?
Yes, we do.
Yep.
Okay, great. So thank you again to those two as well. So I have we have number one, the first agenda item is the consent items. And I don't know if there's anything that anybody wants to take to our public meeting from that. I do want to highlight a couple of things, though, because there's such good information in there. One of them is that we have the Early Learning Intensive support program continued. The ministry made this announcement to us and extended for the 2021-22 school year, so that's good news. Certainly want to extend appreciation to Catholic Education Services for all the Lenten resources that they have provided to the schools that they were continuing to use during online learning. I know that Senior Admin has been working on a calendar outlining the dates to address equity, inclusive, diversity, and inclusion equity throughout the school year as part of our mission to be Christ-like to all. And I'm really pleased about that because we're going to work in those special dates. And then also Catholic Education Week is coming up in May. And we have the Moving in Faith event coming back to us this year. And I know Twyla's been very involved in this. And that one is going to be so unique because it is a virtual event. where we are going to all of the schools and the students and the staff, and we are invited as well. Everybody in the associations, Catholic Association, are invited to add up their steps because we want to make it to Rome. So, and look at all the sites around there. So that's a great idea. Congratulations to all the schools for participating in the Pink Day activities and the lots of activity there. And a name change of our EAL, English as Additional Language, is now going to have a multilingual and a multicultural consultant. So instead of English as Additional Language, so I'm going to change those names very appropriately. And appreciation for 110 computers for self-declared Métis provided to us by the Métis Nation. So wonderful. So at this time, do any of the trustees want to move? Want to move another consent item to the discussion. I asked that already, so we'll just move on to the agenda. We have the agenda in front of us or on screen. Is there any additions? Seeing none, are there anybody opposed to the agenda? Moved by Rob. Any opposed? No, carried. That's the statement I wanted. Okay, so that is carried. And now, do any of the trustees have a conflict of interest based on the agenda that they need to declare? Looking at everyone on screen, seeing none. Then it is, we will proceed. Thank you. Now we have the minutes of March 1st, and there's a recommendation that they be adopted. Is there anything from the March 1st public board that anybody wanted to bring forward? Seeing nothing, can I have a motion to adopt those minutes?
Daryl
moved it. Any opposed? Carried. Seeing none opposed, carried. Thank you, Darren. And now going on to the presentations. And as we have Susan Kohach and Oksana Zvorich, who are Ukrainian program teachers, going to provide an update for us. Is there anything else you want to say, Dom?
No, I think that they're well organized and they've got a great message to deliver tonight.
Okay, ladies, it's all yours.
Okay. Thank you so much, Vicki, and thanks to the board for inviting us to share an update of our Ukrainian program. So Carla and I are going to do this together along with Oksana. If we could just go back, Carla, to that first slide again. Thank you. Perfect. So while we're just looking at that slide, I've got a few things to share. This is the 42nd year of the Ukrainian program in Regina Catholic Schools. And over the years, the location and the method of delivery has changed, but not the importance of learning about our Byzantine Rite, culture, and language. We have 56 participants this year, and our attendance has ebbed and flowed with COVID numbers, but overall we have stayed very steady and we're very pleased with the registration numbers that we have. Our students are coming on Wednesdays from 4:30 to 6:30, and Thursdays from 6 to 8, as well as we do an online information component on Mondays for our students and our parents. I have to say, and I know Oksana is in agreement with me, that the evenings are working out great. Our students are attending more because we don't have to worry about the day system. TPD days are not an issue any longer. Conventions and other school activities that before had kind of, you know, prevented attendance. We had to change the way we instruct this year, but that's just like everybody else has had to do with this change in our world. Carla, could we go to the next slide, please? So one of the goals, well, we have three goals. We've got our Byzantine Rite traditions. That's our number one goal with our program. Our Ukrainian culture and our language acquisition. And this is a picture, obviously from last year, of our kiddos with St. Nicholas, who comes to visit them before Christmas. Next slide, Carla. Now, Byzantine Rite. The Byzantine Rite has a very strong sense of the sacred, the mystery, and tradition. There is a much heavier emphasis on the divinity of Jesus. Our Mass is referred to as a divine liturgy, and it's sung or chanted with the congregation, and the congregation takes a very active part. The sign of the cross is made numerous times, and so when we work with our students, we teach them our prayers, and we do the sign of the cross three times before we say the prayer and three times after we say the prayer. In the Byzantine Rite, icons are what we have rather than statues. And we also have an iconostasis, which is an icon screen which separates the altar from the congregation. And again, we spend a lot of time with our students teaching them about what an icon is, the significance of icons, and of course our iconostasis. Those are some of the things that we highlight. We also do, of course, just like in the RC, we do our saints every month and who the saints are and our saint feast days and so on. Unfortunately, this year, due to the COVID restrictions, we were unable to tour our two churches, St. Basil's and St. Athanasius. In the past, we've always made sure that we take the children there. Next slide, please, Carla. All right, so this one is about our language acquisition. So certainly it is a part of the program. And for the beginners, which are the ones that I have, it starts with the alphabet, and the Ukrainian alphabet has 33 letters. Very few of those letters are similar to the English alphabet. In fact, some of the letters that look like an H in the English alphabet is actually pronounced as an N in the Ukrainian alphabet. So it's a little tricky for the kiddos to begin with. But as they become familiar with the alphabet, they're able to read simple phrases, simple books, and Oksana's students, she has the older group, they've even written some children's books. You can see in one of the pictures there for my beginner class. And simple phrases and words grow into more conversation and dialogue. We have found this year the use of Seesaw with our students and parents has been a very effective way for us to communicate as well as share information, videos, and instructional information. So really it has been a godsend, the Seesaw this year. We're really appreciative that we're able to partake in that with our students. Next slide, please, Carla. So Ukrainian culture is one of our other big goals. And the culture is intertwined with the Byzantine Rite. So for example, our Christmas and Easter traditions are really steeped in the Byzantine Rite. The students really enjoy learning about the meaning of the symbols on the Pesachnya, which is the Ukrainian Easter egg, the blessing of the Easter baskets and what foods go into the Easter baskets and the meaning behind all of that, the importance of the first star on Christmas Eve, and the folk songs that we teach them as well. We make sure they understand the meaning of them. The older students in Oksana's class are able to paint stained glass, and they have produced some very intricate embroidery as well. Now this year, we were able to make Pesachnya, Ukrainian Easter eggs with our students. You can see some pictures there of them working on them. But unfortunately, we were not able to bake our Paschas with Ababas at the church because of COVID. And I know our students really missed that. And so did our Ababas. They really look forward to the kids coming and spending some time with them. But hopefully we'll be able to do that again next year. Next slide, please. So community. Now that's an important, the whole reason that we want the students to learn about their Byzantine Rite, their culture and their language is that they will be able to share that with their community members. Now in the past, we've done that through performing at the Holodomor Memorial at the Legislative Building, Rotary Carol Festival, caroling at St. Basil's Manor and Silo Gardens, Mosaic and the Taras Shevchenko concert. Now again, this year, as everybody else, we were limited. However, we did have our own Holodomor Memorial, We continue to sing with our students following all the COVID guidelines and protocols. And we were able to perform for the virtual Tarashevchenko concert, and that was hosted by the UCC Saskatchewan. Unfortunately, we were unable to spend time with our seniors, and I know that they miss the children singing and talking and visiting with them very much. But again, we have been able to share our singing and the memorial for Holodomor with our parents via Seesaw. I'm going to turn it over to Oksana now to take you through the rest of our short presentation.
Thank you, Susan. The next slide. Thank you. So Holodomor, those of you that are not aware, the Holodomor is a genocide that happened in Ukraine in 1932 to 1933. 7 to 10 million people were starved. Most of them were children, so they were starved by Stalin. So we always have a Holodomor ceremony at the legislative building. And just a little bit of information, it is observed with over 70% of the MLAs as well as the Ukrainian community. So it was very well supported by the province. The next slide. So the benefits of learning of a second language, as you can see there, increased critical thinking, creativity, enhanced communication skills. The only other thing I want to add with the bottom is inclusiveness. We really are happy with how that fits into our program. So it's just an excellent piece. Next slide. Student eligibility. Everyone is welcome. Students may enter at any grade level for grade 1 to grade 8. Homeschool. We do have a couple of public school kids this year, Susan. I forget how many.
Oh, we just have the one family. We had several families who were very interested, but the cost is rather prohibitive. So, you know, we probably would have more if the cost was a little bit lower, but as it is, we have one for sure.
Okay, thank you. The next slide. So what our program offers, as you can see there, it is the Byzantine Rite to learn the new language, to keep their promote and enhance our culture as well as to keep it alive. Of course, make new friends, have fun, showcase their learning, and enjoy the cultural and faith-filled field trips. Next slide. Thank you. Now, the importance of this program, this is a mainstay to the Ukrainian community. Education and the continuation of our Byzantine traditions and rites engages the youth of any background in the continuation of the Ukrainian language and the culture. What I want to just conclude with is deep learning of the Ukrainian culture and language. It enhances tolerance, acceptance, and inclusiveness to our youth and society, building character and compassion to be carried on in their adult lives. The Catholic faith and the Byzantine Rite teaches the acceptance of all. We are living this assurance of faith with the continuance of the Ukrainian program. Expanding the faith-based teachings and policies that the Regina Catholic School Division has been built on. And then just a little side note, my husband always says we need to brag about our program, and we often don't, but I'm going to do this one brag, and he actually reminded me of it. The Patriarch, which is the Pope of the Ukrainian Byzantine Rite, he visited our Ukrainian program a few years ago, and he only visited our program in Canada. So we must be doing something right. I mean, I think, Vicky, you were there. We had a wonderful program at Miller, and it was very exciting to have a man of that magnitude with us. And that's it. Any questions?
No, any questions from the trustees? I don't see anybody raising their hands right now. But
we must have done an excellent job.
Oh, Susan, I must share with you, though, and with the trustees. It's too bad it's COVID and pandemic time, because I would just encourage everyone to go, and I would love to go back and visit your classrooms again and to be invited to one of your programs, because it's inspiring. It's just so wonderful to see all of those children singing in Ukrainian and performing and showing off what they've learned. And your classrooms are just wonderful, welcoming places. So I really appreciate what you brought forward to us tonight and sharing it with our trustees again. And keep up the great work. It's awesome.
Well, thank you for your support. We greatly appreciate it.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much for giving us a few minutes of your time. And absolutely, once COVID is over, and hopefully that'll be sooner than later, we would love any time to have visitors come.
Okay. Thank you, Lynn. Appreciate everything.
Maybe, can I make a comment?
Okay, Bob.
Okay, I just want to say what I really was impressed with is the fact that you two have decided to embed or to use Seesaw and use the technology to be able to get the kids connected during COVID. I think we were all worried that the program might not be able to have as big of an impact when COVID hit. But I really want to say thank you to you two for very much for adopting the new way of connecting, getting your parents in. I know how difficult it is to get parents connected at the best of times, but this is on after hours in evening. So kudos to you two for keeping the Ukrainian community connected and doing with the programming. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, thanks, Bob. And for the rest of the trustees, Bob has a strong Ukrainian background. Awesome. Okay, so again, thank you. And we're going to move on now to our student trustees and the principal of Dr. Martin Lopez, where these students attend, is going to introduce them. So Lawrence, I think you're online somewhere if you would like to.
Yes.
Okay.
I am. Hello, everybody. Hello, trustees, Director Domscalia, and our superintendents. Certainly is a great pleasure that we have to introduce our two Strive members, Ian in grade 11 and Sarah in grade 12. It's important to note that Sarah is our original Strive member from Lobolas Catholic High School, and she is graduating this year. I know they're busy with remote learning. They've just got back from their Easter holidays with the rest of Block 3 this week, and preparations for remote finals next week, which will be an interesting go at assessment and finals. I'll turn it over to Ian and Sarah. I know that they are well prepared, as they always are. So at this time, I will turn it over to Ian and Sarah.
Thank you, Lawrence.
I'll be going first. I'm on the SRC at Lobolas, so some of the activities that we did before shutting down were a challenge wheel. And that includes lots of little activities like finish the lyric. And those activities were COVID safe, right? We also did many dressing up activities to keep the students engaged. And then after that was finished, we had plans to do some activities for Easter, including a color wars, which is each grade is assigned a color. And if you show up to school wearing that color, you get a point. And however many items you are with that color, you get, so like you get that many points, right? And then the grade with that, or the grade with the most points at the end, wins something. And then in past years, might have been a period off or something, but I doubt that was going to happen this year. Unfortunately, since school shut down, we weren't able to do that, and so the SOC hasn't mentioned anything of the activities coming up soon. But in previous years, those activities at lunch were super important for Lobolas, and lots of people showed up, but this year it's been kind of quiet. I mean, people are supposed to not really stay. I mean, people aren't really supposed to stay for lunch. And so you'll be finding less people anyways, but even the people that are at lunch, they're just not motivated to go up and participate in these activities. So the SRC is trying what they can to do to get everyone more engaged, but it's just not looking the best right now.
Ian?
All right, yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so I was just going to talk about like what we did for Lent. So we obviously couldn't do our pancake breakfast because that's not really COVID safe at all. So instead, we just really promoted our Chalice fundraiser, which we do every year for kids in Haiti and the Philippines. And as the kids from Haiti slowly age out, we're replacing them with kids from Mexico. So we're still maintaining the same amount of kids. And I think that this year we had an online donation thing and lots of donations came in online. So that was a really good addition. And lots of people who would have been spending their money at the pancake breakfast, I think we're just giving their money in their period five classes. So I think we did a good job on raising money for that. And then for our mental health capacity building, we had a bench donated to the school called the Buddy Bench. And it just sits at the front doors kind of to remind people that you can just sit down, talk to your friends, like you're not alone in this. Everybody's in this together kind of thing. And then something that for online learning, all the teachers that I've had at least have been using the same platform. They've all been using Teams, which is really great because last year all teachers kind of picked their own platforms. So it was a little confusing, but remote learning is a lot easier now to navigate and definitely a lot better because all the assignments are in the same place and you don't have to go through a whole bunch of different apps to find what you need to do for the week.
Anything else? No? I'm going to, is this a good time to ask the trustees if they have any questions? Dean and Sarah?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, good. Okay, thanks. Any questions from the trustee or comments? Shauna?
Ian and Sarah, just thank you so much for looking at so many innovative ways for keep everyone engaged through COVID, doing your best that you possibly can. It sounds like you're doing a lot, and I just want to wish you well in your remote finals.
Yes, and we see in the chat there that there's lots of thanks from the trustees for all that you're doing, Sarah, and boy, you've been with us since the beginning of Strive, and we wish you very well in your graduation, and unfortunately, we don't know what that's going to look like yet, but we're hoping it's going to be a great celebration for you as well. And Ian, thank you as well for being involved in the SRC. I know it must be challenging trying to think of activities that are going to work during pandemic, but your commitment is there, and I know you're doing the best you can, and I really like the idea that challenge wheel and the dress up. Unfortunately, the color one didn't work, but I think you'll find a way to fit that one in. That sounds amazing. Sarah, thank you for all of the work that you're doing. That buddy bench, I know that's a very important for mental health and the online learning. I know with those platforms and finding using Teams, it's much better now. So I really thank you for your reports and for all of the work that you both do for the student body in your schools and trying to make it a really conducive atmosphere and climate for learning and for relationships as well. I know it's difficult, but you two are really awesome. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, thank you so much. So I think that's our report from our Strive for tonight, and we'll just move on to our decision items now. So we have number five. The first one is 5.1, preventative maintenance and renewal. And that's the PMR, and we otherwise known as the PMR. And each year we receive we apply for budget money to keep up with the renovations and upgrades to our facilities and any replacements that we may have. And this year we are asked again to make a plan to update a three-year plan for PMR funding and submit it to the ministry. So this is just saying that there's a recommendation that the board approve and authorize the senior leadership team to proceed with processing and submitting a three-year plan as required to ensure inclusion in the program. So we don't want to lose out on any funding, and we always have repairs and upgrades to do. So there's a motion here. Recommendation. Can I have, do you have a question? Okay, question first. Ryan.
Yeah, thanks, Madam Chair. Just had a question. When I was looking at this preventative maintenance list, and it was just more or less a seek to understand question. How did we come up with the list for the PMR? Was there any type of a needs assessment completed to end up with the current list to help me understand how we ended up with the items we did per year?
I think Doug, is Doug online?
Yes.
Okay, Doug, would you want to answer that?
Yes, good evening, everybody, Madam Chair. Yes, there is a audit process that has been done. It's done every 4 or 5 years. And at that time, the auditing team suggests projects to be done. The date in which the project to be done can be done, doesn't have to be done within the year that is specified. You have a range to be able to move a project in and out. But the answer to your question is that, yes, there is an audit process for the projects.
Just to follow that, the one that stood out, I see you have a card access system. It looks like about over $700,000 over 3 years. And so that must have fit into the needs assessment as something that was a good PMR item then.
Yeah, it's a safety item regarding that. And you'll see it. Yeah, it's a multi-year investment into it.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Look online. Any questions from anybody online?
Bob put his hand up.
Bob?
The question I have, Doug, and I'm not questioning what you have, it's about, I noticed that in for the shop, you're looking at doing a replacement of the collection dust collection system. Will there be any issues with the ministry looking us having look at the shop, or will they be this because it is part of the PMR?
I'm sorry, Bob, you cut out on me in the last.
Okay, I guess the question really simply, Doug, is this. I understand that the PMR really is a targeting school-based things like roofs and access cards, whatever. But when I look at the shop, you're looking at a new dust collection system. Are we going to get challenged on the dust collection system? Ask.
We probably won't get challenged for that because PMR can also be used for safety.
Okay.
And in this particular case, this dust collection system does not meet current standards for dust collecting.
Okay, that's all I need to know is that it's a occupational health hazard.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
That's all I need to know. Thanks, Doug.
Okay, Doug, I have one question. There's a replacing BUR in a number of places, but I don't know what BUR stands for.
Oh, that's a roofing material.
Oh.
Built up roof system.
Okay, thank you. I didn't know. It sounded like a berm.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, Vicky, it's more like a burn in your side.
Yeah.
Okay.
When you see these tar pots or the smell of tar on roofs, that's what BUR is.
Okay. Thank you very much. Well, glad that we're looking forward to seeing what needs to be done in our division, and you're going to be submitting this three-year plan upon our recommendation. Is that right?
That is correct.
Okay. Do I have a motion?
I'll move it, Vicky.
Okay, I saw Shauna's hand right away, Bob.
Okay. So
Shauna moved. Any opposed? Carried. Okay, thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, Ryan, for your questions. And going on to the next one is the school playground structures with special needs accessibility. This was an item that came up earlier to us, and we discussed it in closed. And we feel that there's a need to address some of our play areas for accessibility and special needs. So the recommendation is here. Are there any questions from our trustees first on this? So the recommendation is that the board direct the senior leadership team to create an administrative application that addresses school playground structure for students with accessibility needs. Can I have a motion to approve that? Okay, I'll pick Darren. Okay, Darren moved that we proceed with this recommendation. Any opposed? Seeing none, carried. Thank you very much. The next one is a full day kindergarten, and I know that the board deliberated about this long and hard, and we have decided that we would like to move forward to the next school year in approving a full day kindergarten every other day, an alternate school day based on the 5-day calendar. So could I have a motion, Ryan? Ryan, I saw your hand on my screen too. So, okay, Ryan moved this recommendation. Any opposed?
Question,
Rob?
Yeah, I had a question here on, I'm very supportive of this, but just on, do we run it like every second day, or will it be like every Monday, Wednesday, and every second Friday for a class? Just wondering how that works.
It sounds like it's on alternate days, but I'll let Dom explain that one to you, Rob.
Yeah, the senior leadership team are still working through those details. We'll have those finalized quickly. The intent is once that schedule is finalized, we'll be communicating that with the family.
I just got a couple questions on that. Just if there was some way like to keep the continuity for daycare and work schedules and all that kind of stuff, if it was Monday, one class was every Monday and Wednesday and every second Friday, then they always knew they had a Tuesday and Thursday off. But I'm sure you'll take that into consideration. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay. And Darren, you have a question?
Yeah, I do. And this is to Dom, and I apologize because you probably have no idea what the answer is. But I just want to know if you have an idea of how many parents already registered for the half day in the 2 months we had opened it up.
That's a good question.
Is there a big number?
I'll have to defer to my senior team. They may have that number for you. Off the top of your head, is there anybody on the phone that might be able to provide me with the knowledge of that, or should we just get back to the trustees with that information?
We'll have to get back to the trustees with that information, Dom.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
And no worries, I just, because we had, it's been 2 months or three months and we opened this up, and now we're going to go in 2021-22 instead of...
Yeah, for sure.
Yes. Recommendation. Yes. Before.
So this is
an action item
is to proceed and find out that information. Mm-hmm. Okay. So therefore, could I have a motion to proceed with this recommendation? I just need to look at. I think Rob has. Rob,
no,
did you?
Juliet. No, Juliet. Juliet, this.
Oh, Juliet, I can't see her. Oh, there you are, down there, I think. Okay, Juliet has. Okay, Juliet moves this recommendation. Any opposed? Carried. Thank you. Now, in the next one is an education property tax mill rates, and this is for Catholic school divisions, basically, and we have a constitutional right to levy the education property tax and set its education property tax mill rates, and we have to put a motion forth every year to do this, to maintain our constitutional right. I know the ministry sets the mill rates, and we usually follow along, because if we set them lower, we will be deducted that from our operation fund. So we usually maintain whatever the ministry sets, but we maintain also our constitutional right to levy those. Okay, so by adopting this, the tax mill rates as set by the Lieutenant Governor in council for the 2021 taxation year, that's what we will be doing. Okay, whatever that is. So can I have any questions on this first? Rob, do you have your hand up?
I'll move it.
Okay, Rob moves this, okay. Any opposed? Okay, Carrie, thank you, Rob. Perfect. The next one is the COVID RCSD staff vaccinations. Given the concern that we have with the number of variants in Regina, and about the teachers teaching in congregated settings when they are in the classroom, there's a recommendation here that given that Regina is considered to be the hotspot of increasing cases of variants of concern, which continue to pose a threat to the operations of schools for students and staff, it is recommended that a formal letter be sent to the Saskatchewan health authorities, both local and provincial, requesting that all Regina Catholic School Division staff are vaccinated at the earliest possible time. If necessary, the Regina Catholic School Board would provide the necessary logistical support to the health region to facilitate staff vaccinations. I think I have, and I know that you have, as well as often as you can, advocated for this for the last while. We want to make sure that our advocacy efforts are heard, and we feel that a formal letter would at least show that we are serious about this and it doesn't fall on deaf ears. So, Bob, I know that you wanted this recommendation put forward. Do you want to speak anything else to it?
I do. I just want to say that given the fact that I know that the province is prepared to make exceptions for emergency services and they're starting to vaccinate police officers, emergency staff, fire department personnel, and so on, I think that it really is a matter of how soon we're going to be able to see our staff getting vaccinated. I know that may put additional pressure on them. I believe that the Regina Public Schools would join us in this initiative. And I believe that both teachers' federations, both local associations already have been advised by their presidents to contact their MLAs and to press for this. And given that we are in a variant of concern hotbed, I think this would be a fair thing to do. But we also need to understand that even after the variants have attempted to slow down, that in order for the city or the province to remove this high level of concern from our area, you must wait for 28 days after the last variant has been removed from its contact and isolation time before they will remove that high level of concern or that level that they have placed Regina under right now. So right now that looks like that could take us till the end of June if things don't go well. So I'm really encouraging us to be able to get that letter as soon as possible and to press on it, because I think there's some imminent things that we need to be aware of. And we will see this over our shoulders at least till the end of June at the rate we're going right now.
Perfect. Thank you, Bob. Therefore, we have a recommendation there. Can I have a motion?
I'll move it.
Okay.
All our hands went up really fast.
Everybody's hands went up, but Bob, since you were the initiator of that, we'll have Bob move it. Okay. Anybody opposed? No, everybody's hands went up, so nobody is opposed.
Anybody opposed, I'll beat him with a stick.
Vicky, can I just say, I have my hand up, actually. I wanted to make a comment, but I don't think you saw me. Can Dom or Twyla sort of help you watch the hands? I think it would be better.
I
can't. I don't have the screen. Okay. Ryan will watch it, because you know what, Juliet? Sometimes I see your letters and sometimes I don't, so that'll be good.
That's okay. Thank you, Vicky.
Okay. So nobody opposed? Okay, so Carrie, thank you. And we'll get moving on that right away. And I will share with you that I did share this information with Adam Hicks, the chair of the Regina Public, and they're bringing it to their board.
Okay. I have a question.
Yes.
Sorry about this, Madam Chair. Could we contact our local MLA, or do you want a speaking note that something that we could either personally deliver or email or talk to on the phone
to our local MLAs? We could do that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Because it's hard to hear. Silence.
Yes.
And then it's a unified, and we're saying the same thing.
And please tell them that we're putting this letter forward.
Yeah.
Okay, that would be
it. To the director, and then I have no problem.
That's right.
Talking to
contacting our MLAs. Absolutely. So I think that's a good idea, Darren. Let's do that. Don, do you have that down? And Twyla can help us put something together.
Sure.
Perfect. Thank you. Okay, now this is a discussion piece, and this is the Government of Saskatchewan GOS estimates, and I think Ray is going to lead us through this document. Okay, Ray, are you there?
Good afternoon, everyone.
Okay. Hello, Ray.
Yes, I did put a memo in the package on what the announcement was for last week. The government made a big fanfare about increasing school divisions funding by $19 million. And they neglected to say that was down from the previous year. Last year, they gave us a $42 million increase as part of the sector, but we'll take the 19. But the only increase they gave to us was for the 2% for teachers' salaries. So they admitted that they weren't giving us any additional funds for any inflationary pressures that we experience. And of course, the RCSD does increase other employees' salaries on an annual basis, and everything's going up. The carbon tax is going up, our utilities are going up, everything's more expensive this year than it was last year. So we will have to continue to make difficult decisions as we work through the budget process in order to fund the continued operations, essentially, making sure that we're offering a quality Catholic education to our students. So if Carla advances to the table on the second page, you can actually see where some of the ups and downs were in this little table. This is the funding we received, so it's expense to government and ends up being revenues to us. And I had to take some liberties in the third one, the base instruction, to sort of notionally figure out where it was last year, because they just gave us a set amount for the teacher's salary increase and they didn't disperse it between the different categories. So I just put it all in that base instruction for the comparison. But really, it's in a number of categories, including base instruction, supports for learning, and the link contracts as well. So you can see those going up by a substantial amount as well. So overall, the short answer is we are going up by 1.3%, $1.4 million, but really we're going to have to make all those tough decisions that we've been speaking about all the way along, including changes to transportation, full-day kindergarten, and amongst other things as we work through the budget process. Coming down a little bit further, you'll see the enrollment, which we are showing a modest change from what we had in this year's budget. Of course, we didn't receive any budget adjustments for our decrease in enrollment that we actually experienced. The government was good enough to maintain our funding for the current year without making any adjustments. But they have informed us that they will be going back to their traditional patterns of changing funding based on actual enrollments in September. So it's really critical that we get as many children registered, many students registered as possible in order to make sure we don't experience any untoward reductions in funding throughout the year. A little bit further down, they announced our PMR for next year as well. And that you can see is going up by $215,000. And really that just gets us back to historic levels. Last year was a slight decrease just due to the timing when they sent some funding to us. So really that's more in line with what we've experienced in the past. So of course that just gets added to the fund and gets spent over the next 3 years. The government also made a big production about saying they had funded the school divisions for around $20 million in order to support them to get ready for next year. Of course, that's previously announced money that they've already given to us. And of course, I've informed the board that we received around $1.3, $1.4 million this year that we're allowed to take forward to next year to get ready for how we're going to support students next year. So that's still in the mix as well. But overall, we're very pleased our funding didn't go down, but we have not received enough funding to carry on without making changes to operations. Also attached to the package is the full funding package that we all school divisions received from the government. And this should look familiar because it was just distributed last year. It was distributed earlier this year. And now you have this one to compare it to. They said that they didn't make substantive changes to the actual funding model, which is quite interesting to see. But of course, really, they just lifted it for the teachers' salaries. And this is what came out. So, Madam Chair, I will stop there. And
any questions from anybody at this point? We're really trying to absorb all of this, Ray.
Vicki.
Yes, Bob.
I guess you're like, Ray, I really appreciate the work that you've done in this, and you've really got down to basically picking up the truth of it, which is a very minimal amount of money just to cover our teachers. But the portion of it that you really identified was that there was no additional funding for inflation or for those other cost factors that we are facing in the division. So as we go forward with that, we're going to need to have a sense of what that really means for operations. So when we meet with our MLAs, both the provincial, both the government MLAs and the opposition, that we have some additional powder to fight with when we meet with them for our annual twice a year meetings. Because as much as they say, yes, we've supported you, I understand the province is fairly tight with funding, but this really is basically still leaving us in the lurch or we have to become the bad guys and deal with some significant reductions in services and programs. And I think we're going to have to document the impact of that. And I'm really looking forward to you providing us with some information as we go along that we can help use in our discussions with them. So thank you very much for your work, Ray.
Yes, absolutely. Juliet has a question.
Yeah, hi, Ray. My question is quite simple, and you might find it funny, actually, but this is a quick, not funny, but anyways, this is a quick question. So in your report, I believe it's page three or so, where, you know, you had 2.1 million to continue to support Following Their Voices, which is an initiative to support First Nations and Métis students. I'm wondering how much is allocated to our division, or is the amount there, and then like how does that work?
So there's a little background. I think the question is for the First Nations and Métis Education Achievement Fund. Is that the one you're referencing?
Yeah.
Yeah, we would have to go to the funding document we received from the government, and they would actually have the calculation there, and they would list how our amount was determined versus every other school division. I don't have that memorized quite yet, Juliet, but I can certainly get that to you and to the rest of the trustees separately.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and that really does not mean that we have an increase, or like you don't know, right? You wouldn't, or do you know if we had an increase, or just it's the same amount of funding? There's a noise in the background. I don't know if you can hear me. It's like it's raining somewhere.
Yeah, I can hear it as well. The of course, this is just the funding we received. How we spend it is really the choices of the board. And so, you know, it doesn't say that we have to spend this amount on these certain aspects. You know, we take all the funding in, and we take the funding we've received from outside the provincial government as well. And that forms the basis of our budget for the revenue side of things. And then, of course, we look at how we want to spend the money and what are the initiatives that we're supporting.
Okay, thank you.
Ray, I have a question. The largest decrease you mentioned is $67,000 for transportation. Is there any rationale for that?
Yeah, there was a lower ridership.
The low ridership. So if we increase our ridership next year, the COVID was over, are we going to get that back?
We'd probably get it back in the next budget. We won't get it for this year.
Oh boy. Okay, Shauna?
That's confirming.
Yes.
Because it was encouraged that if you could take your kids off the bus, that you do.
Mm-hmm.
So that's concerning that we won't have that funding because many will be returning.
Mm-hmm. Oh yes, that is concerning.
Can I just ask a follow-up question, Vicky? And this is, again, based on the transportation. So, Ray, when you say we have a low ridership, this rain, the noise. Isn't one of the factors based on the fact that, when, say, for example, a bus driver tested positive, then all the students won't, be on the bus for 2 weeks, or, because they are on isolation? Doesn't necessarily mean that we have low, the number of students going on the bus has increased. It just means because of COVID restrictions, students aren't allowed to go on the bus for 2 weeks. And so you have that, low rate of transportation, or what does that mean?
It's really reflective of how many families have signed up for bus transportation services. And it's quite right. Our ridership is lower this year as we've encouraged parents to transport their kids to school themselves.
Okay.
And this is another example of where we receive funding from the provincial government. In this instance, they've designated us to receive $5 million of funding for transportation. But of course, the division spends a lot more than just $5 million on transportation, because we provide the specialized transportation. We have the yellow school buses. And things are going to go up when we move to the new service provider, but things should stabilize once we get there. New service providers, I should say.
Hmm. So if we reduce a transportation to what we get, there would be a lot of families impacted, wouldn't there?
Yep.
Yeah, okay. Holy, okay, thanks, Ray. Any other questions?
Vicki, I guess it's more for an observation. So Ray, when we're talking about ridership, but we also made as a decision as a board, because we had some challenges last fall, that we would increase our operating costs on budget, on busing, by putting additional bus runs in to address ones we did. So we made some choices of this last year as a board in order to provide better service to our clientele, if you want to speak. So we brought some of this on ourselves by choosing to be charitable, understanding, and taking care of our families' needs. So this isn't always about the government cutting our services or funding. It's about us also choosing to provide more service than what we are getting funding or eligible for funding for.
Right.
A fair comment?
Yes. Right. Yeah, that's accurate. I mean, once again, the spending decisions are ours to make.
Yeah.
And we have accommodated the families to get the kids that want to go to school to school.
Yeah.
Ashana, and then to Juliet.
Was the recommendation for parents to keep their kids off the bus this year, if at all possible, was that part of our back to school or return to school plan that was presented to the government?
Ray?
Oh, it most certainly was. And in fact, it dates back to June of last year when the government releases reopening the school plan. And their first recommendation is, where possible, parents should transport their children themselves. So we adopted that language almost identically in our plan that we released in August that was reviewed by the chief medical health officer. And that's something we've been reinforcing with the parents at every chance we've had. But unfortunately, that doesn't result in, you know, savings this year, because we had to maintain the 92 routes. You know, we did experience decreased ridership, but again, it was a smattering. It wasn't every bus had 10% less when we were able to consolidate buses. It's been quite the challenge, obviously.
I just wanted to emphasize the point that the government was aware that we were to reduce our ridership this year, and that it was due to COVID, not a new trend.
Yeah.
Okay. As we're proceeding through our budgets, we might have to do some lobbying to the government to get some of that 67,000 back, especially if we have full ridership in the fall. Like, how are we going to pay for that? So anyway, that's just a comment, Ray. I'm not expecting you to do anything about it right now. But that's just, we are going to have to kind of really approach this subject. That's for sure. Okay, any other questions, trustees? I think
Vicki, could we diarize it come in the fall, that when we see the updates on a student transportation in the fall, that if we see an increase in ridership coming up, that at that time we revisit this with the idea of writing to the Minister of Education and the Minister of Finance to be able to make those types of adjustments? I mean, they can always say no.
That's right.
And they put us in this position, and we're basically following through. And we, once again, you know, we cooperate with the government on their directions, and we penalize ourselves for choosing to be cooperative. So I think this is one for us to be able to reflect back to them, that if they want us to change a policy and direction, they need to be prepared to put some money where their mouth is when they're making those recommendations and changes.
I agree totally. We have to revisit this and see what our ridership is in the fall, and then proceed with a plan. Okay, what we're going to do about it. Because if our ridership goes up because we are back to school, then we should definitely have that $67,000 for transportation. And more. Okay. So anyway, thank you very much for that, Ray. I appreciate that. If there are any questions. Dom, you've got that in the minutes. And Carla, thank you. Okay. No other questions of Ray? Okay, we'll move on then. Next item on our list is the strategic plan update, and it's policy 16. And it's about transportation. Every month we review a policy or two or three. This month has transportation. This is the policy about it. Are there any additions or things that we need to add from this policy? We need to. I know you've had an opportunity to review it. If not, if you have anything else you want to add, it goes back to the policy committee. We discuss it and see what we have to do, and then we'll bring it back to I don't see any hands. I think it's good as it is. Okay. Good. Thank you. Thank you for reviewing that. Moving on. Senior leadership team reporting and the SMART goal for educational technology data. And I think that's Dave, isn't it? Dave, I know that you presented to us here, all of the education technology, the surveys, and the integration of the learning improvement plan goals and so on. Do you want to make a general statement about this to us and open it up to questions from the trustees?
Sure. Just in general, this year we've seen a ton of growth from all staff at all levels. COVID has pushed us to expand our technology and to support teachers in new ways. So some of the highlights this year have been, and it's been highlighted by our students, is the effort to move to two platforms. So we've had MSS Teams or Microsoft Teams and Seesaw in our K-6 group. And you can see in the survey here that both have been very, very well used. In terms of Seesaw, just to give you some updated numbers, I met with Jenna and Jen today, and we had 74,000 interactions last week before Easter break. In the 4 days leading up to Easter break, there were over 74,000 posts and interactions. The other program that has really helped us along is Clever. Yeah, if we click on that one. So in the PowerPoint, if you watched it, you'll see all of the different icons going across the bottom. Those are all one-stop shops now. Just by accessing Clever through our website, students and parents can log into that. And that was a huge complaint last year during supplemental learning, was the fact that parents had to remember 10 different passwords and usernames, and some of them were quite long and challenging for our little guys especially. So moving to Clever this year has really helped streamline that. We saw over 22,000 logins and interactions on Clever on those 4 days prior to the Easter break as well. So changes that we've been able to do, this is for the year, these stats, but just in the last 4 days before Easter, we've seen a huge uptake. So the team has been working really hard to make sure everybody's had that in place. So it's been very successful this year between Seesaw, Clever, and MSS Teams. So, I think one thing to highlight, our PD has really changed this year as well. We've had to do all of our PD virtually for the most part, and we've been very successful with switching that over. We've been doing a lot of 20 and 20. So in the mornings before school or after school, we're running 20 minute PD sessions with just a very quick blast at one very specific thing. And so staff are able to log in, learn how to do one thing very well in that 20 minutes, and then go and try it with their students and that. So it's been very successful, PD that way. The other thing that we've really worked on this year is our Connected Ed program has changed quite a bit. We've looked at a new model, realigning it, redefining the role, and shifting to a three-year term starting after next year. So there'll be an opportunity for other teachers to continue to learn and grow and use technology as we move forward as well. So we've been able to do this within the existing budget without any budget increases. So I think that's a big win for us. And we look forward to seeing what it's going to look like next year there as well. Looking to next year, the last slide there, we're going to continue with Seesaw. The success and feedback from parents and teachers has been outstanding. We'd like to move it into our 7 and 8s. And that way we've got our entire elementary covered with Seesaw. The benefit of that is it does allow our administrators to see into every classroom and into the Seesaw. It also becomes a place where we can push out messaging to all our parents through emails as well as through pop-up messages and that. So it's an easy way to communicate with all of our stakeholders as well. Doing this, we might be able to eliminate some other programs as well that we may not see a need for as much. The other thing that we're continuing to look at, this year we rolled out My School SASK, And for the high schools, we used the grade book there for this year. It's okay. It's clunky. It's not as efficient as we would like it to be. And there's a few challenges there. So between our elementary and our high schools, we are looking to test out or look at EDSB next year, which would be a report card that could potentially be used right from pre-K to grade 12, which would create consistency again in our division. So there are things that we're looking at for next year with that. And Connected Ed is also new, is going to look different next year. And last thing we've been really working on is our software budget. Again, recognizing that there's overall budget pressures as a division, we've reevaluated the software that we currently have, and we're hoping that anything that we do add or bring in next year will come out of the existing dollars. So there'll be hopefully no increase in dollars. But we're just in that process right now.
Thanks. Thank you for this, Dave. That's really encouraging to see how well we've improved in technology and how the platforms now are really on a roll, and they're doing what we want them to do, and the teachers and the students are happy with them. I have one question. What was the program that the government or the ministry wanted us to use for the high school grade book? Wasn't that My School?
MSS, My School SASK, yes.
Yeah. And there's the satisfaction with that is not there. Is that right?
No. Currently, right now, the way that it was rolled out in the province is we were part of wave two. There's a wave three coming out this year with the last of the school divisions that will be joining. And one of the challenges we found is that we are currently about we are four by the time we get to the fifth or the third wave, we'll be five versions behind. And so many of the changes will be addressed, hopefully. But right now we're working on a two-year-old program. And in the world of technology, that's a long time to be on the same level of platform. So we're hoping after next year we'll see some of those changes. But what we're also seeing is there just isn't the flexibility in MSS to do what we really need to do and to share with our parents in order to have a full picture of how their children are doing in terms of reporting to them. Many of the school divisions have already purchased EDSB. EDSB interacts with MSS, so it is compatible, but it is an additional cost that's not supported by the ministry.
Ryan, then Shauna.
Yeah, actually, Juliet had her hand up, and mine was after her, so I better be a gentleman and let Juliet go first.
Oh, there you go. Okay, Juliet.
Thank you, gentlemen. Ryan, thank you so much. Dave, thank you. Thank you for the report, and thank you and your staff for such an amazing job. It's, you know, technology is something that evolves, you know, by the second, and so it's a cat and mouse game to catch up, you know. So I thank you for what you've done, and also to really just get our teachers as well prepared and well equipped as well. And the information is quite positive. I think that you know, I was quite impressed, really, you know, to see that by June, you know, our teachers would have met the ISTE, you know, standards at 100% of them. So I think that is fantastic. That's brilliant. My question is, I think I have just two questions, really. I think the first one you kind of covered, and I think, you know, Vicky also asked the question about the MSS and, you know, 2.2%, you know, satisfaction is quite, you know, it tells a lot. But I would also want to know how the students also feel as well in terms of, you know, their accessibility and you know, how they see the program. And also, of course, the teachers as well have also, you know, let us know how well they like the program. So that would be, you know, something I would think I would really want to see how, you know, students also, you know, like the program. And also, with Seesaw, I actually thought it was, just, you know, the whole elementary from to grade eight, but I'm seeing now is not, you know, grade seven and eight aren't really using CISO, and correct me if I'm wrong, but if they are not, I'm wondering, what other programs are they using, and why are we switching to CISO then if it's working or if it's not working? And you may have covered, you know, in terms of the cost as well of switching to CISO, you know, what's, you know, the additional cost. I know it doesn't come, you know, cheap. And just a comment, really, not a question, is, you know, again, I really appreciate, you know, the trainings and support that our teachers have. But I think we also need to keep in mind, too, that our teachers are not, you know, instructional designers, right? They're not, you know, they're not, their job really is not to, you know, make sure that their PowerPoint slides are beautifully designed and all that, and, you know, they have a cool background and so on, you know. So we really need to be careful, as not careful, but I think you know, let's just keep that in mind in terms of expectations as well. I know that, you know, they have to be trained in facilitation and collaboration and all that, but I'm also picturing, you know, especially our elementary school teachers who have maybe grade one and grade two students, and good luck facilitating grade two, you know, students, right? All they want to talk about is, you know, what they ate and the color of their shirts and so on. But I think again, just really, Dave, thank you for providing those support for our teachers. Yeah, so if you can just answer my questions. I know I tend to talk a lot, but thank you for listening.
Okay. Juliet, I have to go back. The first question, I think, was what was the student response to MSS? Is that right?
Yeah, and so parent and student feedback has been mixed reviews on it as well. We do track user logins, and they're way down in comparison to last year in terms of parents going in and checking marks out from our old Student Achieve parent portal. So we have seen a drop in engagement from parents in terms of checking assignments, and that kids can go in. I think kids are more adaptable. They don't mind it, but it's even to them is not as clear. I know teachers have had a lot more questions from students this year in terms of where their mark is or how they find things. So there is some work on that end as well that we need to make sure we're doing. I think your second question was around CISO and why we aren't using it all the way to grade eight. So we do have a program called My Blueprint for our grade seven and eights, and we had originally been using that the last 3 years with our grade seven and eights. It does include a portfolio piece in it as well. But we're finding that as we move it to CISO with our pre-Ks to grade sixes, that our seven and eight teachers are finding CISO way more user-friendly, especially this year being remote learning. My Blueprint does not have that capability, whereas CISO, we're able to put in lessons and we're able to put in interactive pieces for the students, and it's just it's a way better tool overall. So we've heard loud and clear this year from our grade seven and eights teachers, as well as our administrators, that it would be nice to have everybody in the elementary on the same program, which would be CISO would be our first choice for that. Cost-wise, it will cost us about $50,000 to do pre-K to grade 8. Currently, it's about $39,000, so we're looking at about a $10,000 increase to continue and to expand it into the grade 7 and 8s. And like I said, our goal or our hope is that by reviewing our software budgets, we're able to cut a few things out that overlap and that may not be deemed necessary. In order to make room for CISO in our current budget.
Thank you so much, Dave. And Vicky, thank you for repeating my question there. But, you know, Clever is such an amazing tool as well. So thank you for adding that. That really, especially for my family, it really did help a lot of, you know, not just my family, but a lot of, you know, families as well, right? Students can actually just go on one website and they have access to everything. So again, great job, Dave. Thank you so much.
Thanks. And just with that, thank you for bringing that up. Clever is free with CISO, and it benefits more than just CISO. So it came with CISO, but were able to use it within our entire division because we had purchased Seesaw for our pre-K to sixes. So it was a really nice addition that we hadn't realized when we purchased Seesaw.
Wow, good. Good perk there. That's excellent. Yeah. Excellent. Thank you for your questions there too, Juliet. Shauna, did you have a question? Or Ryan?
Yes, thanks, Madam Chair. And thanks, Dave, for that great information, and Juliet for leading into the piece about Clever. It really is an excellent system to be able to go in and access all of the programs for within the students. For my question, Dave, when you spoke about the 74,000 interactions, mm-hmm. when I think about that, is that good or bad? It sounds good, but I know with 11,000 plus students, I always like to see big picture with percentages, and just some that I guess in the future that might be some of interest too, like how does that compare percentage wise, and especially looking back at before Christmas and what our participation rate was like. So I guess more or less a comment, like 74,000 interactions sounds good, but and I believe it is good, but I don't, percentages really help me see the big picture for participation rates.
Yeah. Well, I can look at that. I can say that, and I think it's in the slideshow here. Carla, are you able to go back up to the Seesaw? I can get that information, but So over the course of the year, you can see some of our numbers here. What I do know is from our December numbers, we're up about 20,000 from the 2 weeks prior to Christmas, and then the week after and the week before Christmas break. So we're seeing higher numbers right now. So more uptake, more engagements through Seesaw there. But we'll monitor these, and I can certainly provide an updated report just on Seesaw use for us at the next board meeting, especially because we'll have the numbers from our online time.
That's great. Thanks, Dave. But just on a side note, too, I heard today that SaskTel removed the data cap charges for people and devices. So that could be beneficial for our families as well. I think SaskTel carried that into June or the end of the school year. So that ties hand in hand with this as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Shauna?
We've got out over 700 devices during this remote time right now.
Okay.
Just a quick question, Dave. With the connected educator classrooms, is the goal long-term for every classroom to be a connected educated classroom, or is the goal to always have it on a rotational basis and only certain classrooms within the school?
The goal is to not have it in every classroom. When we look at the research, one-to-one is not the answer. And forcing teachers into a pedagogy that they don't feel comfortable in or follow is not always best either. And so that's why we do the Connected Ed program as an application and a process through that, because we want those teachers to be ready for that move. I think we'll continue. We have to revisit next year again, and hopefully, you know, budgets are a little better and we're able to continue to keep growing the number of teachers that'll be connected eds and get them into more classrooms. But our goal has never been to have them in every class, because we do have different styles. And even with best practices and pedagogy, it's, you know, we've got teachers who are outstanding without technology. Technology adds a tool to their belts or to their collection of tricks that they can use in the classroom, but it's just a piece of that puzzle.
Perfect. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Thank you for that, Dave. Lots of good information there, and really appreciate the work you put into this and the report. Thank you very, very much. We're looking good. Okay. Going on to number two, trustee remuneration and expense allowances report. And trustees, you have that as information. And if you would turn to the back of that page, can you turn to the next page there? Just a caution to you that in the linkage committee per diems, we do have it capped at 25 meetings per year. And with the number of meetings that we have been participating in, a lot of us are getting very close to that. And that means that the rest of whoever has met their quota will not be able to claim whatever linkage meetings we do from the rest of the year. Those who haven't continue to claim, but after 25, you will not be able to claim that as a per diem. Okay. And the rest is information for you. Any questions on that?
Vicki, can I make a comment on that? This is going to sound strange coming from a guy that normally would say, let's be very cautious. I'd like us to be able to review that in our next budget cycle, because I'm thinking if we have, we're continuing on with COVID, when we've had more meetings than planned on, and there might be exceptions of why we need to do it. And I know we can't do it now, because we certainly would add additional bottom line to our dollar. But I really, if we don't do that, at least to have some other recognition, because I have to make a point with the government or with the SSBA that because of COVID, we've had additional work that we had to do, and that really has increased our cost significantly this year, regardless of the amount of money we cut it.
Yeah.
So I know I'm out of money. That's not the point. I'm not going to be getting any more. I'm not worried about it.
Okay. Bob, could I just interrupt you? Can we move that into closed?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so we'll move that into closed and have a discussion on that, okay? Okay, the next item would be quarter two, the budget forecast and actuals, and that's your baby again, Ray. Want to talk to that?
This was actually presented to the planning meeting, so it's just now going into public. The trustees have already reviewed this report, and they reviewed the next report as well.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. Yeah. Any questions on that? I think we asked all the questions, I think, at the planning meeting. Thank you. And the next one is the board policy number 16. Now, whenever we have a policy review, we usually have a report from the senior administration on that policy. And we have been informed all along about transportation by Ray, who looks after that area. And so this is just a brief report, just basically outlining what he has provided to us so far. And I know that it continues to be an item of concern and discussion for us as we move through this budget year or so and planning for next budget. So any questions on that, trustees? Any comment from you, Ray?
Well, once again, the detailed reporting was actually provided to the trustees at the planning meeting. So we've had a chance to ask questions on this, but I'd be happy to answer any other ones that come up.
Juliet, do you want to ask a question?
Yeah, no, Ray, I think you're right. I think we reviewed this, but I was reading this again, and I'm curious, and this is just a comment, or maybe actually it's a question. How do we measure client satisfaction again? So for students who take the bus, how do we measure their satisfaction? If you can just clarify that, really, that's all.
Yeah, that's a tough one, and really it's more anecdotal, because all the phone calls we get are complaints. It's very, very difficult to meet everyone's expectations, especially when there's such an expectation gap from some parents that the bus will be there exactly on the scheduled time every day without exception with the same driver. And it's very, very difficult. So we look at really anecdotally, what are the level of calls we're getting? What is the nature of the calls? Is it beyond the ordinary, my child has to walk so far to the stop, or the bus wasn't there exactly on scheduled time, that we look at, what's truly that we're not meeting to their expectations.
Okay. Question, Julia?
Yeah, no, that's all. Thank you for the clarification. Thanks, Ray.
Okay. Thank you, Ray. Appreciate the report tonight and your explanation. Very good. Thank you. I don't think there's any other questions. Moving on to the chair's report. I just want to mention that every Thursday morning I have a meeting with the chairs, all of the chairs for the province with the SSBA. Basically, it's an update on the pandemic and what's being done when the PPEs are coming and the number of cases. And I do provide that in my information as trustee information's weekly information items for you. So I do provide that report to you. The other thing I want to make mention is this week on Thursday, April 16th, the SSBA Spring Assembly occurs in the evening, 7 o'clock till 9. And then on the on Friday, it's all day. There will be networking meetings for the SCSBA under that, as well as we'll have a constituency one as well. Okay, so just a reminder about that. And that's all for my report. Anything from trustees or committee reports? Okay, Ryan?
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. Just going to report in on our Holy Rosary Community School Review Board Trustees Ad Hoc Committee. We've been quite busy in the month of March. Essentially, we were successful in establishing a committee where we've had our terms of reference approved, and also the development of a partnership application form, which is on the homepage of the RCSB. Right now, we're in the process of sharing that and getting the word out and communicating it, with the hopes of potential partners filling in the application to show their intent of interest in perhaps being a partner in this project. So far, we had 5 organizations express interest via email, and some of those come in through the job form application. We've also met with the federal political politician of the federal level, as well as provincially with the Regina SaaS Party MLA. So we have a meeting scheduled at the civic level with the counselor for in this here area that where the school resides in. So we've been busy working through that. And we do have our next meeting coming up April 28th. And actually prior to our meeting today, and we just did a tour of the facility. A couple of the committee members, we went through it just to kind of get a better idea of what that footprint looks like and what kind of space we have available. So our committee's been working very hard. We had a good march, and we're hoping that we can come through and have some good partnerships, and we really want to succeed in this project. Thank you.
Thank you, Ryan. And I want to thank you for your leadership on this committee and all of the, and the trustees that are involved with it, doing some great work and having very important meetings and discussions. So thank you very much on behalf of the board for doing all of that. Okay, so the next one, any other updates or anything from trustees?
Juliet's hand was up. I think it was up from before.
Okay, Juliet, your hand up. Okay. The next one is the director's report then.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I have a number of items listed in my report. Kevin Cameron's violence threat and risk assessment leadership. The calendar committee has put together a calendar for next year that reflects diversity, equity, and inclusion outcomes, and they will be identified either through prayer or curriculum. March was also busy for the LEADS membership, and that's all our ed services and HR and supervisors and myself. We had our AGM. We also had our CEC staff retreat, which was really outstanding, well led. By our deacon, not Deacon Joe, but Deacon
Eric.
Yes, and he did a fantastic job speaking from his heart and telling personal stories, and really connected with a lot of the staff here. And it came at a much needed time for our staff here at CEC. We also managed to have our Catholic Connections forum, and I was happy for that. Dr. Campbell will start his four-part series with us this month. We also ran our discernment series, our fourth session. For the new trustees, the discernment series is a five series package that we offer to people who are aspiring for leadership. And so this year we have 14 people who are taking the five sessions virtually. And it's really well received. Also staying connected to CPAC, getting some valuable information from them. And this year, the University of Regina usually hosts their President's Breakfast in September, and we usually have several tables that we buy to support the athletics program at the U of R. This year, it took place virtually. There was no breakfast, but 3 outstanding speakers. Claire Hanna was amazing as well. So that's my report, and if there are any questions, I'm happy to answer those questions.
Okay, Brian, and then Derek.
Great. Thanks, Madam Chair, and thanks, Dawn, for that great report. It looks like a heck of a busy
April. I know. When I got done, I was wondering, wow, a lot happened.
One thing I just wanted to ask about was the calendar committee. It just sounds fantastic. And being able to look at those different events and being able to capture a prayer that kind of fits the curriculum around that topic.
Yeah.
And in here, it said the draft of the calendar was attached. But I apologize. I couldn't get it or I couldn't open it. And
it may not have been attached. I'm not sure. That may have been a miss. So we will get that to you.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah. I'd really like to see it because I noticed in the last communique, Twyla mentioned that April 28th, the day of mourning for workers who died on the job. So I just want to take a look at it too, just to see some of those other topics that just to be sure that we get a good capture of all those different special dates.
Yeah, and on that day, we should be flying our flags at half mast. And so we will be doing that this year.
Okay, good. Shauna, you have a question?
Oh, no, I'm just stretching.
Oh, okay. Darren, did you have a question?
Yeah, thanks, Dawn. I'm just wondering on number one there, the violence threat and risk assessment.
Yes.
Is that an out of country or out of province company?
He's from Alberta, originally from Nova Scotia, Madam Chair's hometown.
Yeah.
And it's a company, and he's well known internationally because ever since Columbine, he was the person who first attended and did an analysis on what caused those two young students to create that mass shooting. And ever since then, he's been the first responder. In fact, when we had the incident at LaRange, he provided the leadership and direction to the staff on how to respond to the trauma, as well as the bus accident in Humboldt.
I'd just like to add to that, because I did watch him and listen to him. He addressing the learning lags and his approach, which he talked to the administration as well as don't know if the teachers. And anyway, he's saying, as we get together and come back from the pandemic in the fall, don't look at the deficits and the learning lags. Look at the positive. We are together again and build that up, because that's what will motivate the kids. It's not looking at, oh, look what we've lost and look at the all that you didn't learn or anything. Look at us, we're going ahead now and we're able to learn together. So he brought up a really good point, because I've been caught in saying a learning lag and just turned that right around. So I thought that was really good advice.
Yeah, and my I just want to just kind of talk about it. We have probably one of the world's leader here in China.
And that is?
Buckingham Security and Solutions. So we've got, they're right in Regina.
Wow.
They've been involved in their you just go to their website and check it out. It's all
never heard of it.
And they are all over the world now. And
okay.
Buckingham Learning Solutions?
No, Buckingham Security.
Security.
And Solutions.
Okay.
We'll look into that.
Yeah,
that
sounds, they're local. It might be
readily
available for, probably could do every school.
Okay, perfect.
And assessments and workshops, but they're right here in Regina.
Okay.
Thank you. And thank you for that report there, Dom. Yeah. I don't see any other hands. So we're going to go ahead here to the community linkage. There's minutes from the committee meetings. And I don't think there's anything to just there for your information. Everything, Carly, you did a great in capturing all of that. Thank you. And then the letters, the Office of the Archbishop, LP3 Transportation Solutions, contract termination, Easter letter to the staff and the families. And that brings us to the next step. It's a closed session. Can I have a motion to go into close? Ryan, any opposed? Okay, carried.